write what you know, so they say. All I know is I don't know what to write or the right way to write it. This is big, lady, don't screw it up. This is not the little vlog. Will I breathe you in? Poor little kids versus rich, pretty, sour. This is fun. It's a stage. It can practically write itself. And let's pray it does. Because as I may have mentioned, I have no clue what I'm doing. And what I'm saying, this is what I've been waiting for.
Reading from 1 Samuel 17, 3 through 8, 38 through 39, and 48 to 50. Hear what God's saying to you. The Philistines stood on the mountain on one side, and Israel stood on the mountain on the other side with a valley between them. And there came out from the camp of the Philistines a champion named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. He had a helmet of bronze on his head. He was armored with a coat of mail. The weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of bronze. He had greaves of bronze on his legs and a javelin of bronze slung between his shoulders. The shaft of his spear was like a weaver's beam, and his spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron. And his shield bearer went before him. He stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why have you come out to draw up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? And are you not servants of Saul? Choose a man for yourselves and let him come down to me." Saul clothed David with his armor. He put a bronze helmet on his head and clothed him with a coat of mail. David strapped Saul's sword over the armor, and then he tried in vain to walk, for he was not used to them. Then David said to Saul, "I cannot walk with these, for I am not used to them." So David removed them. When the Philistine drew nearer to meet David, David ran quickly towards the battle line to meet the Philistine. David put his hand in his bag, took out a stone, slung it, and struck the Philistine on his forehead. The stone sank into his forehead, and he fell face down on the ground. So David prevailed over the Philistine with a sling and a stone, striking down the Philistine and killing him. There was no sword in David's hand. Here ends the reading of words that give us insight on God. May God grant us wisdom and courage for interpretation.
Are you ready to hear it? It comes from Newsies today. How many of you have seen some version of Newsies? A few of you have seen one version or another of Newsies. So Newsies is the play that made its Broadway debut in 2012, and it was well received. It's based on the not so well received 1992 movie by the same name, which is in turn based on the real-life newsboy strike of 1899. In the movie, we see Jack Kelly and a group of newsboys who sell newspapers. Most of them are living out on the streets. They don't have families to speak of except themselves, the newsies themselves that have banded together. Early on, a new group of newsies come along, a couple new kids named Davy and Les. And Davy and Les are a little bit different than the other newsies because they have a home, they have a family, but their father has lost his job, and so they're helping to sell newspapers to help the family meet their financial needs. Jack is kind of the unofficial head of the newsies. And so he decides to take in the new boys, Davy and his younger brother, Les, largely because Les is a cute kid, and Jack thinks it's harder to say no to a kid selling a newspaper. It's not a glamorous life, but the newsies are good at what they do. They're good at selling the papes, as they call it. Cut to Joseph Pulitzer, who owns in the show the New York World, and he's bemoaning that he's not able to keep up the same circulation numbers after the end of the Spanish-American War. As he puts it, whoever said that war is hell wasn't trying to sell newspapers. He needs to get circulation numbers up, and so he concocts a scheme. He decides that he will up the price for the newsies, because the newsies buy ahead of time, there are no refunds, they buy 100 papers for 50 cents. So he decides he'll jack the price up to 60 cents for 100 newspapers, and they'll have to sell 25 more per newsie to get the same amount of money. This is, by the way, what happened. There were multiple newsboy strikes in the late 1800s. There was one in 1884, 1886, 1887, 1894, and then this one in 1894, where the publisher of two newspapers, Joseph Pulitzer and William Randolph Hertz, did jack up the prices of the papers from 50 cents per hundred to 60 cents per hundred for the newsies. That meant that, as our newsie this morning told us, since the newspapers cost a cent per newspaper, the newsies were making a half-cent profit. They had to pay a half a cent. They sold it for a cent. They made a half-cent profit. In the show, the newsies are understandably outraged when they find out about the price increase, especially since it has been the same headline week after week, trolley strike. Who wants to read about a trolley strike? You need a good picture and an exciting headline to sell newspapers. Isn't that right, Phil, our newspaper guy? He knows. So they're furious. How are they going to get their money? And so Jack decides to lead a protest. And people begin to get excited. And they make a new friend, Catherine Plummer, who's a reporter. And Catherine sees a gateway into better stories if she covers this one. And so she decides to cover the newsy protest. The next day they all come back, and Jack fails to properly motivate all the newsies. He's not so great with words, but Davy is good with words and helps them to get excited. And they decide to do an all-out strike of New York World Magazine. It's not a very long strike, though, at least initially, because there's a chaos, a protest, conflict that arises between the newsies and the strike breakers and the police. And in the chaos, Jack's friend with a disabled leg, who they lovingly call Crutchy, gets beaten and taken to the refuge, which is a corrupt boys' home. And it looks like things aren't going so well for the newsies. But Catherine goes and begins writing. And she compares the struggle of these powerless newsies against this giant of a publisher to the struggle between David and Goliath. Thanks for the scripture suggestion, Catherine. You all know the story, of course, at least the broad sketches of David and Goliath. It's talked about in popular culture probably even more than we talk about it in church. And so, you know, whenever you hear the names David and Goliath, that we're talking about an underdog story. You know that there are two armies, the army of the Philistines and the army of the Israelites, and they're in a valley. And the Philistines have this champion named Goliath. And every day he comes out and he shouts, "Send your champion! Send your champion for me to fight." And no one is coming forward from the Israelite army. Now Goliath is an intimidating figure. The sizes of his height vary. In the most authoritative ancient manuscripts, it says 4 cubits and a span, which would be the equivalent of 6 feet 9 inches. Is anyone 6 foot 9 inches? Is anyone over 6 feet? 6'2". Where's Dan Haslam when we need him? 6'6". So you can visualize someone who's about 6'9". Some versions of the text, like the one we heard this morning, say 6 cubits and a span, which is about 9 feet 9 inches. And scholars think that's probably scribal error, looking at the 6 from verse 6 in the line above, or perhaps inflating his size. But it doesn't matter. He's an authoritative figure. He's big, he's imposing, and no one wants to face him. Now, Saul was king of Israel. And Saul was having a rough time as king. Things weren't going real well for Saul. But Saul would have been the natural person to step out against Goliath, even though he was the king. Because we found out earlier in the book that Saul stood a head above any of the other Israelites. That meant that he was about 6 feet tall. And we find out later that he had some pretty good armor, too. But Saul ain't stepping up. And so Goliath comes out every day, "Send me your champion." Saul's not stepping out. Enter David. David is just a little boy, one of Jesse's sons. He's the youngest. He's one who's not going to get the inheritance. He's the one who is out watching the sheep, that dirty, filthy work that nobody wanted to do. But he had 3 brothers who were serving in Saul's army. And so one day, his father said, "Stop what you're doing and go take him rations." And so little scrawny David grabs the rations and he goes to the camp. And whenever he goes, he hears the Philistine come out. Send your champion out to face me. And David says, perhaps because he's too young and stupid to know the difference, he says, I'm going to go. And they laugh him out of the camp. But he doesn't give up. He hears the rewards, too, that Saul's going to offer. And so he goes to King Saul himself and says, I'll take him on. And Saul says, I don't think so. He says, I'm going for it. Saul says, okay, here, you can at least put on this armor of mine. Of course, it doesn't fit little scrawny David. He can't even move in the stuff. And so he takes it off and he throws it aside and says, I don't need it. And so he takes a staff and a sling and 5 stones that he gathers up from a wadi. And he goes and he stands off against Goliath. They have some ancient name-calling, some spitting at each other's gods, and then they're ready for battle. And Goliath says, David, come to me. And David says, no way. He said, you come towards me. And Goliath, not thinking this little kid was any threat, starts charging towards David. And David takes out his sling, and he slings the rock. It hits Goliath square in the forehead, and he's down. This little kid, the one from the pastures, he's the one who defeats Goliath. Now, it's worth noting that if you read the book of 2 Samuel, it says that someone else actually slayed Goliath, not David. And so it's possible that since David was more famous and this story made a pretty good backstory for a king, they just attributed it to David. It's also worth noting that these kinds of champion battles didn't ever really happen, certainly not with Israelites and Philistines. It's more reflective of a Homeric epic. In fact, if you read the Iliad, there's a scene just like this from which perhaps this scene was borrowed. But it doesn't matter because it accomplishes its goals. There were 2 goals here. One is to show us that Saul wasn't fit to rule, and that David was going to be the true king. And the other thing is that David is chosen because he is the least likely to succeed. This little kid, this little scrawny kid, the poor, the weak, the lowly, that's who God chooses. Have you heard that before? Seems like we hear that every week, right? Because that's the story of the Bible. That it's the one who you don't expect who gets chosen. I mean, the boy, the last in line, the one who's not even going to receive any inheritance, the one who doesn't have any battle training, the one who's taking care of the sheep, the one who doesn't have any armor, the one who doesn't even really have any weapons. That's the one who wins the battle. Over and over again, God chooses the one who you don't think God's going to choose. And then that person rises to power. And even in the Bible, if God's chosen person gets too powerful and forgets where they came from, God chooses somebody else. And so I think that's an important lesson for us to hear, right? It never says in the Bible that it's wrong to have privilege and power, but it does say that it's important how you use it. Do you use privilege and power to lift yourself up, to create more power, more privilege, more money? Or do you use that to stand with the one who God chooses? So in Newsies, Joseph Pulitzer clearly uses his power and privilege to get more money for himself. He exploits the Newsies who don't have any money to begin with. They're already living on the streets. And things are looking bad for the Newsies. Crutchy is now at the refuge with the corrupt leaders there. Jack is kind of hiding. But then Catherine Plummer comes along, and she has good news for the Newsies. She has written an article, and her article is on the front page, and it is about their protest. And so they start to get heightened. They start to feel good because they know that maybe if they just put a little bit more pressure on Joseph Pulitzer, that maybe they could win this biblical epic, this battle between David and Goliath. But, you know, Joseph Pulitzer, he uses nasty tricks. He uses leverage on Jack. And Jack discovers that Catherine Plummer is really Catherine Pulitzer. Her father is Joseph Pulitzer. She's still sympathetic to the cause, but her father has told her no more writing articles that are going to cost him money. But you know, once Brooklyn, a key borough, is on board with their strike, they've got an idea. They realize that if they can control the headline, then they have the power. And so they decide to publish their own newspaper with some help from Catherine, who also happens to know just where they can find a printing press in the basement of her father's building. And so they print their own paper and they sell it, and they even send a copy to Governor Teddy Roosevelt, who's not a big fan of Joseph Pulitzer. And so Teddy Roosevelt comes down and adds some pressure, and they eventually strike a compromise. The strike is going to end, and they're going to split the difference in the price per hundred of newspapers. It's going to be 55 cents. In history, it stayed at 60. And the paper decides that they will buy back any unsold newspapers. And that really happened. So the strike is over. Teddy Roosevelt closes down the refuge, and all responsible parties are held accountable. Crutchy is released, and it looks like things are going to be at least a little bit better for the Newsies. This is a powerful story because it shows us what can happen when people without much power bond together. Whenever they combine their power, they can make a difference. And it also shows us what someone with relative privilege can do to use their privilege to stand on behalf of others. Catherine Plummer, Catherine Pulitzer, had a little bit of privilege and decided to use it to help those who were in need, and it made a difference. So extra, read all about it. Here's the good news today. The good news is that God has anointed you, yes, you, to carry the banner of the good news, to go out into the world and share God's love by standing on the side of those whom God chooses. Go forth and share that good news each and every day of your life. Amen.